interesting. So the final speaker for today is Manuel Adana Reina, who I met when he came to Galway on sabbatical, and we had a good few discussions on informal care. And before COVID struck, we were going to do a piece of work together. But I was interested in a Spanish perspective a little bit on what the things we were going to talk about today. So over to you, Manuel, and welcome to the webinar.
Well, thank you. Thank you to the AES and to the Center for Economic and Social Research on Dementia, and very especially to Professor Imo Moche for inviting me. What I'm going to speak about today as a respondent is about making a small comparison between the Irish and the Spanish model of care, and to link it with some of the studies as I have done about the socioeconomic profile, preferences about caring, and social cause of dementia, basically in the south of Spain, but this is where I mainly work. I would like to start by telling you something about myself that I think it could be helpful. When I wake up, the first things I do in the mornings is go to my bathroom, I look in the mirror, and this is who I see. This is me. Or at least, this is how I see myself. I see someone who is handsome, who is successful, and attractive gay, yes. The problem is what you see is the other gay, the one on the right. What do I mean with this? What I mean is that most of the time, the people who organize the social and health systems, the policymakers, have certain ideas about what they do that don't always match with those that other stakeholders have. In this last presentation, I would like to give an answer to these questions. Is a person-centered strategy possible? What do caregivers or people with dementia want? Is the current model of care sustainable? Well, what do we have? Dementia is a syndrome that includes impairment at different levels. If we imagine dementia as a dartboard, the center, the main focus, we agree that it is the cognitive impairment. But in a biomedical model, we must include others such as behavioral, psychiatric, and mood disorders. The size of each area can change depending on other factors. Among these factors, we can generalize and highlight two main contextual factors. One is about the general health situation and the stage of the syndrome. And the second is about the social support and integration that includes participation in activities and personal decisions. Well, in a recent study by Susan Cahill, she showed us how the focus on the approach to the illness can shift from a biomedical model based on the reduction of the cognitive, behavioral, and psychiatric symptoms to a more based on human rights and active participation of the person with dementia model, a personhood model. So now the question is it possible to apply a person strategy, a personhood model to the reality? Well, the Irish National Dementia Strategy identify two main overarching principles. One is personhood and the other is citizenship. It means that the general idea is going through a paradigm shift to a person-centered caring model. In a Niamh Hennelly and Imon O'Shea paper, they found that most of the stakeholders wanted a new approach to take hold, as they saw in the answers in the questionnaire they submitted to different organizations and individuals involved in dementia services. In Spain's case, we have a national dementia plan that covers a period, and the current dementia plan, from 2019 to 2023. This plan is designed with the intention to improve the situation of the people with dementia and to involve all the stakeholders that have to do with this issue. But there are two points to consider. And the first one is that responsibilities about the health and social systems depends on the regional governments. And we have 17 regional governments. And the second is that this plan doesn't have a specific budget. And it's quite difficult to apply a plan without a budget. Another question is about the quality of life among people with dementia and the caregivers. What improves the quality of life among people with dementia and the caregivers? Well, it's not an easy question to answer. As Professor Emma O'Shea and other authors have shown, it depends on the stage, who you ask, the person with dementia or the caregiver, the level of preservation of the cognitive dimensions, functional abilities, and other variables such as the education level or sociodemographic characteristics, among others. Basically, these are the three main areas or levels that we can identify as biological, individual, and sociological. Described by Nif Hennelly and Imo Oche in other of the last papers. What do we have in Spain? Well, reading one of the papers of Onya Tihan and other authors, they found a very similar profile with certain characteristics in Ireland to the one I found in Spain. In both countries, it's based on family carers. But in fact, this is a common characteristic across all Europe and in many other countries. Spain is a country with about 47 million people. 10.8 million of them are over 65 years old. And in the area in which I mainly work, the south of Spain, Andalusia, there are about 8.7 million people, 1.7 million of them are over 65 years old. If we consider a prevalence figure of 6.5% of the people over 65, the estimated number of people with dementia are, as you can see in the slide, is a huge number. Since 2006, we have new rights in Spain. They allow us to receive care and support when you are in a dependency situation, not only in the case of dementia, in any dependency situation. It means that the government has to provide services and facilities such as this one, economic support for dependents and caregivers, economic support to pay for a personal service, daycare centers, night care centers, nursing homes, and telecare services, among others. To know if the services fit to the population they are designed for, we should know this population. And that's what we did in this paper published at the Scandinavian Journal of Caring Science. And what did we see? I'm only going to highlight some of the main characteristics. Well, the general profile is that of a woman with an age of 57 years old, more or less, who doesn't work outside the home, with a basic level of education, and who lives with the person with dementia. What I see more important is the profile of the younger caregivers, the one on the right column, those that we define as people under 40s. In this case, they were also women, but the educational level was higher, more of them work outside the home, and in a higher proportion, they do not live with the person with dementia. The profile of the new generation is clearly different from the traditional. An additional point is to value the contribution of these caregivers in terms of cost. If we see it in terms of direct costs, measures in the case of family as payment out of pockets, we can get to the conclusion that family contributions are obviously higher, but in a certain way, both parts, the state and the families, are not so different in proportion. These costs obviously increase with the severity, with the level of education of the caregiver, in our case, with the labor situation, it's higher among those who are in an employed situation than in the other situation possible. It's higher for men, because they used to look for external services in a higher proportion. It's higher for those caregivers who don't live with the people with dementia, no, in general. No? And there are no differences between the public expenditure and the private expenditure. If we compare with the case of Ireland, we do a small review of the Ireland case, we find similar results. Some of them have been mentioned at the beginning. Connolly stated that the total annual cost of dementia care in Ireland was estimated to be about 1.9 billion, and an important percentage of this, 48% of this cost, provided by informal caregivers, basically by families. In the same line, Kelly said that most of the expenses due to caring is assumed by family caregivers. Again, in an important proportion, 32% of annual household income are direct costs, out-of-pocket care-related expenses. In short, as Onya Tihan stated, family caregivers provide the care that the state will have to fund at a higher cost to the citizen. When we see it in terms of indirect costs, for the case of Spain, if we evaluate the contribution of the informal caregivers in this scenario, indirect costs, we see that depending on the method used to measure it, it can be between 1.15% and over 2.57% of the national GDP for the case of Spain. Obviously, these figures are quite difficult to be assumed by any country. A question at this moment is, do caregivers look for external services? Well, since we have the right to provide support in the case of dependency, the truth is that most carers look for external support services. And the proportion is higher if the educational level is higher too. In terms of number of hours, they basically prefer low or medium intensive services. Those are the services that are provided by rehabilitation programs and daycare centers that are between 4 and 8 hours a day. Only the probability to choose for services such as a nursing home increase among those of higher educational level and income level too. Measured by a logistical model, the probability to use external services depends on these variables: working situation, cohabitation, caregiver size, and educational level. Obviously, as you can see, is the probability is higher among those who are in an active working situation, among those who don't live with the person with dementia, among younger caregivers, and when the educational level is higher, and obviously with the income level is higher too. To conclude, there is a tendency to look for external support services. And when we have the right to use it, we use it. The use of these services increase. The preferences are mainly for low or medium intensive services, because this kind of services provide by the government or private improve the integration of the person with dementia in the usual or the natural environment, the social and family life. The traditional profile of caregiver is changing, and we can see it when we analyze the younger profile. And there are certain variables that are important to be considered, like the working situation, the cohabitation or no among people with dementia and caregivers, and education and income levels determine preferences for more intensive support services. So, to answer the three questions I asked at the beginning, well, I would say that to start, is a person-centered strategy possible? Well, the external support services are still designed under a biomedical model. It's not possible to know the preferences of the people with dementia if their willingness are ignored. In the case of Spain, we have a document that I could translate like a anticipated willingness document that you can fulfill in a notary, in which you express your preferences in the possible case in the future that you are going to be in a dependency situation. And this is a guide for the health services and for the family too, but this is not a mandatory document to follow. About the second question, caregivers want to use services that allow them to keep on with their normal life as much as possible in the usual environment. And the last question, is the current model of care sustainable? I think that maybe it's the most important question. The current model of care is an unbalanced model. It's still very dependent on the informal carers and mainly gender imbalance, because it's basically based on the traditional role of women at the families. So the personhood model is our desired model, the model we all want. Policymakers want to say that they are applying it, but reality is never as perfect. We are not there yet, at least in Spain's case. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Manuel. And really good to have some insights on what's happening in Spain. We have some minutes for discussion. So if everybody comes back on screen, I think I have, I hope I have maybe 10 minutes for discussion.